This video is published under the Creative Commons license BY-NC-SA, which means attribution, non-commercial and share-alike. Third-party material has been used for which the permission is specified explicitly for every diagram, photograph or whatever has been used. Please mention the author as Andreas Pfennig, Products, Environment and Processes, Department of Chemical Engineering, Université de Liège, Belgium. A disclaimer applies. Welcome again to this lecture on thermal unit operations. We are still in the section distillation and rectification. And today we want to set up and solve the balances for single stage batch distillation. The last time we have discussed a little bit about the principles of single stage batch distillation. And today we really want to set up finally the balances. Now, before we want to do that, I should recall the nomenclature that we are using. We have been using L for the amount of substance in the liquid. Xi is the correspondingly the mole fraction of component I. D is the amount of substance of the distillate. And Yi is the mole fraction of the distillate. And this is actually the mole fraction that is being produced directly at the interface. And we assume that there is no vapor volume, more or less, or not a significant amount of substance in the vapor volume, so that this Yi is the composition that is directly being removed from the reboiler. Also, the pressure is constant and the system boundary, the boundary of the control volume, is shown in this diagram in orange. And now we want simply to set up the balance for this control volume. So what is the balance about? Before we start that, I should also recall in a very brief way how we set up the balance. Remember, we said that we look at what we have in our control volume, how that within changes. So we can say that the changes within equals what is entering, because if something is entering, of course, there will be a positive change. What inside, what is within will increase. So it's equals the entering minus what is leaving. And then we realize that also components can be produced or they can be disappearing due to chemical reactions, for example. So it's plus what is being produced minus what disappears. And we said that this produced and disappears only occurs if you have chemical reactions and if you regard components that are being produced by chemical reactions. Since in the majority of cases in this lecture, we are not having any chemical reactions, we are disregarding chemical reactions, these two terms do not really occur. So we only have to deal with the changes within, what is entering and what is leaving. And now we want to set up the balances for the control volume shown in the diagram before. So what is changing within? Of course, we have a transient process, that is, everything changes with time, which means that we can only set up a time variable balance, so to speak. So what we can look at is a short interval in time, a differential time span, dt, and look what happens within this differential time span. Now, within this differential moment or time span, what happens is actually that the liquid will change. There will be some change in the liquid, because something is evaporating. And we want to set up the balance exactly for that. And we want to set it up for two different things. On the one hand side, for the overall amount of substance. And secondly, for the amount of substance of component I, of some specified component I. So let us first set up the overall balance. The overall balance means overall amount of substance. Now, what is changing within this time span? There's, of course, a differential change in the amount of liquid within. That's changing within. So it is a dL. And that equals what is entering minus what is leaving. Now, apparently there is nothing entering because actually we are producing vapor and we are removing the vapor from the control volume. So there's something leaving. And this is exactly the differential amount of distillate that is being produced within this differential time span. So the dL equals minus dD. Yeah, this is the liquid that changes, and of course the liquid changes exactly by the same amount as we produce the vapor, and this is something that is positive, so to speak, so that is being removed, and that is why the dL then in that case is negative. So we define, so to speak, the change within, we assume it is positive, we don't know anything about that in the first place, and so we just write dL, and then it turns out in the end that it is negative because something is being removed. The next thing we do is we set up the balance for component I. Now, how much I do we have in our liquid? Of course, the overall amount of substance is L, and the mole fraction of component I is XI. So the amount of component I, the amount of substance of component I in the liquid is just XI times L. And that, of course, is again changing by a differential amount. So we have to write the differential change, D, of the overall amount of component I in the liquid, which is XI times L. And that equals, well, that equals exactly what we are removing by with the vapor. Nothing is entering again, but something is leaving, it's a vapor. And that, of course, the amount is dD, and it has a composition of Y. So we have to write it's a minus YI dD. Now this is actually sort of surprising, the general shape of this equation, because on the left-hand side, the differential is in front of the brackets, in front of the product of the mole fraction and the amount of substance, whereas on the right-hand side, this is not so. So the principal shape is sort of asymmetric. And the question is, where does that come from? Yeah, why does it make sense, or why? What is the reason why we have this asymmetric shape? Whenever something is surprising us, we should look, what is the reason for that? Now, of course, on the one hand side, we have the overall amount of component I in our liquid in the vessel. On the other hand side, we are just looking at the amount that is being momentarily leaving our reboiler. So this is only the amount, and that has a given composition. This is, of course, asymmetric in definition. This is the overall amount of liquid, and this is not the overall amount of the distillate. It's just that small little bit that is being removed from the reboiler. Why does it make sense to set it up that way? Well, because here we can now say that the vapor that is being produced from the liquid, as we have discussed in the last video, that is more or less very well in equilibrium with the liquid. So we can assume that this YI is in equilibrium with the XI. If we would set up the entire thing for the whole distillate, some vessel with the distillate that we collect, then we could, of course, write also that there is a differential change in the overall amount of component I in this distillate vessel. But then we can't say anything anymore about that composition in relation to that composition. Of course, we can also say something, but it's not the equilibrium anymore. We can, of course, set up the balance that way. And that will tell us, well, the change here has to correspond to the change there, of course, due to the balances. So we can also set up the balance for the overall amount of the distillate. But that's not what we intend. What we intend is actually to apply the balance together with the equilibrium. And that requires that we set up here something that is in equilibrium with the liquid. And this is only the differential amount of the distillate that we are producing momentarily. That is, of course, in equilibrium with the liquid, as we have discussed last time. As I mentioned, of course, we can also set up the same thing for the overall vessel for the distillate, but then we would just see the change of the amount of component I in the liquid equals that we would what we would find in the collected distillate, and from that we can, of course, also calculate how the concentration of the collected distillate changes. again with the balance, but it's a different balance and we can't use the equilibrium. This equilibrium has to be introduced this way. So because this is just the momentarily leaving amount and this is the overall content of the vessel, there is this asymmetry in this general form of the equation. Okay, now we have these two equations and now we do the same thing for all balances over and over again. This is the first time, so we'll go through this procedure in a little bit more detail. Later I will speed up a little bit, I leave out one or the other step. In this case, what we do is we use on the one hand side this equation and substitute the dd in this equation. That's what is generally done. We use the overall balance to substitute one of the overall amounts or flow rates or whatever is contained in this overall balance and substitute that in the balance for a given component. And then we do some math, so to speak. Okay, so let's do it exactly in this order. So the minus dd can be replaced by the dl. If we do that, what do we wind up with? Well, it's the left-hand side remains unchanged. It's the dxil equals, and now the minus dd is being replaced. So the minus disappears as well. So it's a yidl. This is the first thing. The second thing we can do is, of course, we can use the product rule to evaluate that. So we can write for this differential, we can write that is xidl plus ldxi, and that equals yidl. Okay, so far so good. What we do now in the next step is to separate the variables. We do that in two steps. On the one hand side, we collect the differentials and the non-differential terms, which means that we have the ldxi here equals yi minus xidl. And now we separate the variables. We leave some space because we want to integrate in just a moment. It's the dl over l equals dxi divided by yi minus xi. And as I mentioned, we want to integrate that. First, we just write the integral. We again leave some space. And of course, we would like to have real values. So we want to integrate from some given lower limit to some given upper limit. The lower limit, our starting point, will actually be the starting point of the distillation process. So that is the L0 over here, and it will be the XI0 over here, where this 0 refers to the starting conditions. So the 0 refers to the starting conditions. We start at the L0 correspondingly with the XI0. And then we have to say something about the upper limits. Up to which point do we want to integrate? That is some specified L on this side and an XI on that side. And now we actually have a problem, because now the problem is nomenclature, and it's just nomenclature. We have called this L, and this is the running variable of the integration, whereas that is some specified upper limit. Same holds here. This xi is the running variable of the integration, also this one here, and this is a specified value of the upper limit. And so we would actually have to indicate them in a special way, but because we want to have L and xi in our final equation, we better reformulate, so to speak, or change the nomenclature so that that L and that x will differ from the upper limit. And what we will just do is we'll add some prime. So we have a dl prime over L prime, xi prime over there, and that's just a question of nomenclature. So we could have just redefined everything, and we could have called it xi prime over here and L prime over here, but I think it's more natural to do it in x and L over here, and then just to say here, well, we have to do something about the nomenclature, and that's what we just did. So now the running variable differs from the upper limit, the special value of the upper limit, the specific defined value up to where we want to integrate. Same over here with the x. Okay, and now we integrate, of course, and we know a little bit about, especially the left-hand side, the integral dl over L, that's the natural logarithm of L. So what can we write? So we have, more or less, it's the ln of the upper limit, it's the L, minus the ln of the lower limit, which is the L0, and that equals, of course, the ln L over L0. And that, in turn, ln L over L0 equals, well, simply the integral. We can't do anything about that, unfortunately. So from xi0 to xi dxi prime divided by yi minus xi prime. And just to recall, this yi is the equilibrium value as with respect to the xi. So this y and this x, they are defined, or they are related by the equilibrium condition. And I put a frame around this equation because that's our final result, and that's the so-called Rayleigh equation. So with that, we get an equation that allows us to calculate the relation between the x and the L as distillation proceeds. For that, we have to know the equilibrium condition. So we have to substitute here the y as a function of x. Then we can perform this integration and determine the L as x changes. Now you can do that, of course, with a little program, an Excel spreadsheet, or a written program that you wrote in MATLAB or something like that. Whatever you do with that, it's always good to visualize that graphically. And that's what we want to do next. And for that, we want to, well, first have a look at the different things that occur here. On the one hand side, for example, we see that we have here the ratio of L over L0. L0 is the starting condition. L is the liquid at the amount of liquid at some later point. So this is less, always less than the L0. So this is always a ratio which is less than unity, meaning that the logarithm of that is always negative. So the left-hand side of this equation is a negative number. On the right-hand side, we have, well, we integrate something, and actually we integrate 1 over y minus x with respect to dx. So we would have to determine this function 1 over y minus x and integrate that over x. And now we want to have a look at how that looks like if we do that graphically. If we do that, it looks like that. I prepared here the corresponding diagrams. And in distillation, one frequently, or essentially more or less always, starts out with this very characteristic diagram. It's the vapor composition in equilibrium with the liquid composition for a binary system. The graphical representations mostly work only for binary systems, some exceptions, of course. But in principle, it's easiest to do it in binary systems. And we see here the equilibrium curve shown in green. And we also see the diagonal, which is shown in black. And we know now this is y. So this is the y as a function of x. And this is, of course, y equals x. The diagonal is y equals x. So the difference between the green curve, the vertical difference, distance between the green curve and the diagonal is exactly y minus x. Yeah, so because here y equals x on the diagonal, and this, so this corresponds to x more or less, and this difference is then distance is exactly corresponding to y minus x. We realize that at the pure heavy boiling component and the pure light boiling component end, the equilibrium curve and the diagonal meet. That means y minus x equals zero, which is of course clear, because if the pure light boiling component, the pure light boiling component is boiling, what happens? Well, we have the pure light boiling in the liquid as well as in the vapor, so the difference in composition is zero. Same holds, of course, if the pure heavy boiling component is just in the boiling state, in equilibrium. If we now plot the y minus x, which is shown here, we get this diagram, the y minus x over x, and we see, of course, again, this is 0 over here, 0 over there, and in between we have some finite value. What we actually need for our integration is the inverse of that. So we have to regard the 1 over y minus x, which is shown here, and since, of course, it is 0 here and 0 there, it means that at these points, the 1 over y minus x tends towards infinity. So there's a curve coming from infinity and approaching infinity as x equals or approaches unity. And in between we have some finite values, which means, of course, that also the inverse has some finite values. Okay, and now we simply have to integrate that. This curve, this is the 1 over y minus x, and we have to integrate that with respect to dx. From some starting value, x1, 0, we start integration, and we know the left-hand side of our equation was, of the Rayleigh equation, was negative. So also the right-hand side should be negative. Well, the value 1 over y minus x, that is positive. So the only thing that can be negative is the dx. So we are integrating from right to left. So the dx is directing in the negative direction. And that is, of course, consistent. We would have expected that. Because if we regarded the txy diagram in the last video, there we saw that the liquid is being depleted in light boiling component, enriched in heavy boiling component, which means as distillation proceeds, x moves to the left. So that is consistent with what we have discussed before. So we integrate now this curve starting from an x1, 0 and move to the left until we choose to have our final value here. Then we can simply evaluate that area underneath the curve, and that directly corresponds to the natural logarithm of L over L0. So it can be evaluated quantitatively directly. And do you remember the question we asked last time in the last video? The question was, where does a process end? And I promised to you that with the help of the balances, we would be able to answer that question. Just looking at the equilibrium, we were not able to answer that question. But now with the balances, let's have a second look. The question was actually, can we say something about the composition of the last drop, or you can rephrase it, can we say something about the composition of the last drop that is evaporating? The last drop, the L over L0, approaches zero, meaning that the logarithm of zero is, of course, approaching minus infinity. So we have to ask ourselves, at which point does this area underneath the green curve approach infinity? Where does the integral of the area underneath the curve approach minus infinity? And of course, that can only occur if the value really approaches infinity. So only if x1 approaches zero do we exactly reach the point where, on the one hand side, the L over L0 equals or approaches zero, and at the same time, the x1 approaches zero. So we can say that there is exactly one defined case of the last point where it's the last drop evaporating, and that means that occurs at x1 approaching zero, meaning the last drop is pure heavy boiling component. So it's neither the case that the distillation stops before we reach the pure heavy boiling component, nor is it the case that we reach that composition and still have some liquid left. Both of that does not occur. What exactly occurs is that as x1 approaches zero, we have our last drop of distillation. So only the last drop of distillation is pure heavy boiling component. And it is pure heavy boiling component. We can say that really with as definite certainty. Of course, with all the assumptions about equilibrium and all those all ideally mixed liquids and things like that. Okay, so we were able to answer that question that we were not able to answer just with the help of equilibrium information. That means directly that shows us how strong the balances really are. They allow us to determine such limiting cases and to describe the overall process. Okay, now the question is, of course, it's nice to have these diagrams. It's horrible to evaluate integrals with Excel spreadsheet or MATLAB or something like that. Isn't there a simpler way? And as always, in that case, engineers go ahead, make some other strong assumptions that actually limit the applicability, but that allow to use a calculator, so to speak, to evaluate the equations at hand. And that's exactly what we want to do in the next step. We want to simplify things further, simplify the equilibrium information, and then tell something about the result. For that, we need to derive some further things, or I should first remind you of certain things. And what we want to look at is something you should be knowing from the lecture on chemical engineering thermodynamics. From that lecture, you should know the property relative volatility. That is defined, or you can write it as an alpha. It is defined between two components, one and two. In this case, you can also define it in general terms as I and J, of course, but let's apply it to our binary mixture, A alpha 1, 2. And that is the ratio of the partition coefficient of component 1 with respect to the partition coefficient of component 2. Partition coefficient, in turn, is defined as the ratio of the corresponding mole fractions. So that equals Y1 over X1 divided by Y2 divided by X2. And of course, we know that all that is sort of related, the X1 and the X2. And now we know, of course, that we apply the mesh equations that we have discussed in the introductory section. So we set up the balances, we use equilibrium, we forget about the balances for energy this time. We don't ask ourselves how much energy do I need. Of course, one could ask that as well and solve that with some heat of enthalpy of vaporization, I would be able to answer that, apparently setting up the corresponding balance, no problem. But in this case, we don't want to set up the energy balance, but we want to use the balance for the component, the summation equation, and that's what we are doing in the next moment, and the equilibrium, we have done that before already. So the summation condition tells us that x1 plus x2 equals 1. And y1 plus y2 equals 1. And with the help of these two equations, we are able to get rid of the x2 and the y2, and then we are able to solve for the y1. If we do that, we wind up with y1 equals alpha 1,2 x1 divided by 1 minus x1 plus alpha 1,2 x1. And now we need to make an assumption about the alpha 1,2 in order to be able to plug it into the Rayleigh equation and to solve that. How do we do that, or what do we do there? Well, we assume simply that the alpha 1,2 is constant. So we assume and that is, of course, a very strong assumption to assume that that is a constant. Well, why should it? Perhaps you remember from the lecture on chemical engineering thermodynamics that for an ideal equilibrium, vapor-liquid equilibrium, usually abbreviated as VLE, especially applying Raoult's law, perhaps you remember alpha 1,2 equals the vapor pressure of pure component 1 divided by the vapor pressure of pure component 2. And why should that now be constant? We realized last time that as distillation proceeds, the temperature changes, and of course the vapor pressures of either component are some temperature functions, and there's actually no reason that the temperature function should relate such that the ratio of the vapor pressures is being constant. Nevertheless, if the temperature range regarded is not too large, then we can assume that that ratio is more or less a constant. It doesn't change so much. If actually the components are relatively similar in their molecular interactions, then we can assume that that is more or less a constant. And even if it is not, we nevertheless get a first impression of how easy or how difficult the separation by distillation actually is. Now, if we apply that this is constant, plug it into here, so that alpha 1, 2 is then just a constant, put that into the, substitute that in the Rayleigh equation, solve the Rayleigh equation with a corresponding mathematical expressions for the integration, what do we wind up with, then we get the final result, ln L over L0 equals 1 over alpha 1, 2 minus 1 times squared brackets, logarithm of x1 over x1, 0 plus alpha 1, 2 logarithm of 1 minus x1, 0 divided by 1 minus x1. And here we can now plug in the, well, we know the starting conditions, of course, the L0 and the x1, 0 are known. The alpha 1, 2 has to be known as well. You have to know the system, you have to know the equilibrium before you can say anything else. The x1, 0 is known, and then we can simply plug in the x1 on that side and calculate the L. So we obtain the L as a function of x1. Possibly you would prefer to have it the other way around. For that, you still need to iterate. But you see directly, you can evaluate that with a simple Excel spreadsheet, with a simple calculator, and because of that, this is called a shortcut equation. Of course, with pretty strong assumptions, assuming that the alpha 1, 2 is a constant, I mentioned to you that that is not really valid for most of the system, but nevertheless, you get a first impression. So this again is some final equation, so that gets a box as well. Now the question is, of course, how can we understand that? Can we get some impression? What does this equation tell us? And so I always like to plot things, so let's have a look at a plot of that equation, of the result of that equation. And this is shown in this diagram. We see the mole fraction of component 1, of the light boiling component, versus, well, unfortunately, this is not L over L0, it's 1 minus L over L0. Why did I choose that? Well, if you plot L over L0, that's a strange function. In the beginning, of course, the L equals L0, so this ratio is unity. As distillation proceeds, L decreases until it approaches zero, so it tends towards zero as the distillation proceeds. That's a weird behavior. Something describing a progress of distillation starting at unity and approaching zero. So I have chosen actually to say 1 minus that, because that starts, if that is 1, then this is, of course, 1 minus that is 0. And as that approaches 0, this approaches 1. So that is now describing the progress of distillation starting from 0, approaching unity. And that, of course, makes sort of more sense to our mind, I guess. And actually, if you look at that in more detail, then this is the amount of distillate divided by the L0. So that is really the progress of distillation starting at zero, approaching unity as distillation proceeds. So that is a reasonable variable to describe the progress of distillation. Starting concentration in the liquid, the amount of light boiling component in the liquid is 25%. And then this equation has been evaluated for several values of the relative volatility. Relative volatility of 1.5 means, with the discussion before, that the vapor pressures of the pure components between light and heavy boiling component, that they have 50% difference. The vapor pressure differs by a factor of 2, by a factor of 5, and by a factor of 10. Of course, well, 2 is already pretty large, 5 is really large, and 10 is really, really large difference. Yeah. And what we see actually is now if we have some ordinary ratio between the vapor pressure, say 1.5 or 2, we realize that the concentration of the liquid, and this is the x, so that's the mole fraction of the liquid, that changes, but it changes only gradually. Yeah, as distillation proceeds, the changes in concentration are not so dramatic. And if you would, for example, ask for a certain purity that you want to achieve in our liquid that remains in the vessel, and you would ask, say, for example, for achieving, say, 2.5% left, so increase the or decrease the amount of the light boiling component in the liquid by a factor of 10, from 25% to 2.5%, which is somewhere over around here. And we would ask ourselves, well, how much would we have to evaporate until we reach that composition? We would have to evaporate something of 90%+, almost everything of 99% and some 97% or so, or 93%, if in these cases alpha equals 1.5 or 2. So we would have to evaporate almost everything before we reach the desired purity. Which means, of course, if we have systems like that, if we have ordinary systems, then the purity that we can achieve will never reasonably be of that order of magnitude that we decrease that by a factor of 10. That makes only sense if the system is so specific that the relative volatility is extremely high, because then if we ask, for example, with an alpha of 10 for a purity of 2.5%, say that is an increase or decrease actually of the light boiling component concentration in the reboiler by a factor of 10, we would have to evaporate something around 40% until we reach that. So we will still have left 60% of the starting amount, so to speak, and that would have the desired purity. And of course, this finite the final composition, that makes sense to ask for that, because if that is, for example, some valuable component, you would get rid of that from the starting liquid, because that's your product. If you have to throw away the rest of the liquid, you have to dump it, then of course you don't want to dump too much of your product with that liquid. And so if, say, this is alcohol water, you have 25% alcohol in your system, and then you don't want to throw away 2.5%. Actually, you want to throw away less than that, because alcohol is a valuable component, not the water, apparently. So that means that such a distillation only works if the relative volatility is relatively high. Fortunately for alcohol water systems, at these composition ranges, the relative volatility is pretty high. So that works for alcohol water distillations, but it doesn't work for most of the systems, or not doesn't work so well for most of the systems. Of course, sometimes you can choose the systems in a special way. For example, chemists, if they prepare some reactions within some solvent, they very often choose ether as their solvent, and that's of course the case because ether has such a high vapor pressure, so such a low boiling temperature, and that means that the relative volatility as compared to the other components of their reaction, that their relative volatility is so high that it's easy to distill off the ether and still remain all the products in their beaker or vessel or whatever they have. So in case you are able to choose your relative volatility, you are able to choose your solvent, you can, so to speak, influence that relative volatility, and by that you are able to improve the performance of the single-stage distillation. On the other hand, in the general case, well, you shouldn't ask for too much purity, because otherwise it doesn't work. Single-stage batch distillation doesn't work for you, or you will wind up only with a very small amount of your product in the end, if you have to distill really with a not so efficient, not with a system that has not such a high relative volatility until you reach a defined purity. So either the system is very specific with a relatively high relative volatility, or your requirements for the purity are not high, or you wind up with only a small amount of product. So that doesn't sound as if it were a very good, a very efficient separation process. Nevertheless, it is sometimes performed, as I mentioned to you, in chemistry, for example, if you want to distill off the ether, or for the ethanol water separation, because there, luckily, the relative volatility is somewhere in that range. Now, before I want to conclude, I want to mention one further aspect to you. And that further aspect is azeotropes. And I want to look at azeotropes only from the graphical point of view. Of course, the setting up the Rayleigh equation didn't make any assumption about the shape of the equilibrium curve, so that was very generally derived. So it applies also for this case where we have an azeotrope. And as you know from the lecture on chemical engineering thermodynamics, azeotrope is characterized by the vapor composition being the same as in the liquid. So vapor and liquid composition are identical, which means that the equilibrium curve intersects the diagonal. And if we now perform exactly these graphical steps that we did before, so we plot y over x, we get such a curve with this intersection with the diagonal. Here we have a positive distance between the green and the black curve. Here it is negative. So if you plot the y minus x, the curve looks like this. You have a third point where the value of the y minus x equals zero. And of course, correspondingly, if you now take the inverse of that, there's a third point where actually the curves, the 1 over y minus x, where they approach infinity. On the one hand side, as you approach the azeotrope from the left hand side, and well, in this range here, actually the value is negative, so taking the inverse of that, you will also wind up with a negative value, so this is negative as well. And of course, you approach minus infinity here and minus infinity there, so the curve looks like that. And now if you look at what happens when you want to evaluate the Rayleigh equation, well, on that side everything is fine. If you start somewhere here with an x1, 0, you move to the left, the value of the function is positive, you move to the left, the area underneath the curve describes the logarithm of L over L0, everything as we had it before, nothing special. On the other hand side, if you should start somewhere on the right-hand side of the azeotrope, what happens there? Well, actually, you realize that now the value of the curve is negative, which means that, since the overall result should be negative, the direction of integration should be positive. So the dx should be moving in a positive direction. Does that make sense? Why is that so? Well, if we look at the equilibrium curve, we realize that the mole fraction of the light boiling component in the vapor is less than that of the liquid. The green curve is underneath the diagonal. So there is a depletion of light boiling component in the vapor. So there is enrichment of the heavy boiling component in the vapor, which means that actually the heavy boiling component is being preferentially removed from the liquid. So the liquid composition will continually approach pure light boiling component, will move in the direction of pure light boiling component. So it will move to the right. So that's consistent. So we start out with some concentration as a starting xi0 somewhere over here. We would be moving to the right, and again, the area between this green curve and the zero, that defines or determines the logarithm of L over L0. So everything fine with that, we can evaluate that, no problem. So if you have such a case, it looks horrible and complicated, and I know most students, if they see that the first time, they get sort of nervous, but actually you don't need to. Why? Well, simply if you regard this azeotrope, so to speak, as a pure component, then this is an ordinary binary system. Everything as we had it before, the diagram is simple in this range of composition. On the other hand side, if you are beyond the azeotrope, if you're on that side, again, regard this as some virtual pure component, regard it like that, and the only thing that is different now from what we had before is that the value is negative, that is the dx is moving in the right direction, but otherwise, this curve, or this case, is identical to what we had before, so nothing special really again. So if you have such complicated behavior separated into individual fractions and then within each range, so to speak, things behave more or less normally. At the same time, I should mention, of course, two things. On the one hand side, sometimes people say also in chemical engineering thermodynamics, you possibly have learned that azeotropes behave more or less like pure components. And considering thermodynamics, well, why is that so? Why do people say that? Well, simply because at the azeotrope, the liquid boils at a defined temperature, like a pure component. As we saw when we discussed the binary distillation, the binary batch distillation, actually, if you're in a general case, temperature changes, compositions change as distillation proceeds, but that is not the case if you start out with an azeotropic composition. There, you start out with a liquid azeotropic composition, the vapor will have the same composition, it will happen at a given pressure and a given, well, for defined pressure, it will happen at a defined temperature, and that's it. The temperature won't change until the last drop of liquid disappears. So that distillation appears to be more or less behaving as if it were a pure component. And so it really makes sense to regard this as something like a pure component. Oh, well, this is a pure component, this is something like a pure component, this is a pure component again. So you actually have two regions between two real or virtual pure components. That's one thing I should mention. The second thing is that apparently, if we look how the compositions change, we realize if we start here, we move to the left. If we start here, we move to the right. We are always moving away from the azeotrope. And that is very general for distillation. It is not possible by distillation without tricks to pass across the azeotrope. So we cannot start somewhere here and move to the other side. So azeotropes are natural boundaries to distillation. It's always tricky to get around that. There are means, adding 30 components, things like that, playing around with some other properties, but nevertheless, it's not easy to pass across the azeotrope. So that azeotrope is always can be regarded as a natural boundary. Okay, and that is not only the case for such a single-stage batch distillation, that holds for essentially all distillation and rectification that we will be discussing in the future. So always beware of systems with an azeotrope, where distillation across that or past that azeotrope is difficult. So having discussed all that, I would like to summarize with some take-home messages. On the one hand side, we have seen that the distillation progress in single-stage batch distillation can be quantified with the Rayleigh equation, and that was very easily derived from the balances. Of course, we have to plug in then the equilibrium after that to come up, for example, with a shortcut equation. We have also seen that single-stage batch distillation is only efficient if the components differ strongly in their volatility, or if the purity requirements are low, or if you only want to get a little bit of product, so if the amount of product can be small. So single-stage batch distillation only works well for certain systems and is definitely not a general separation technique. And then we have seen in the end that azeotropes pose a fundamental limit to the separability of by distillation because, of course, at the azeotrope, the driving concentration difference, that what makes or what is responsible for the progress in distillation, which is the difference in composition of vapor and liquid, that vanishes. There is no difference anymore. So the azeotropes are fundamental limits to the separability by distillation. With that, I would like to say thank you for this time, and I hope to see you again next time.